Hi, everybody, and welcome back to From This Corner TV. I'm Marilyn Dayton, your producer and host, and have we got a treat for you. As you know, we like to do more than just entertain you. We like to share interesting information with you and have a little bit of fun. Today, we're going to have some fun. Remember a while back, we had some students from Guilford High School with us, and we had a very fun show around them making a movie, which was very exciting, and they had the magic. Well, here we are again. We have some students with us and a teacher from Stonington High School. They made a movie or two or three or four or five or more. And and they just recently had their premiere at the Mystic Theater, and it was amazing, fun, exciting. It had a theatrical poster on the wall and a red carpet. Very exciting. It was very enjoyable. So let me get started introducing you to who we have with us. On the far left, we have Evan Jesse. Then we have Nick Robinson, Elias Sandlin, and Mr. Dane Lewis, our teacher, who was a hero in the show.
A hero.
Movie magic. I love it. I just love it. So let's go back to the very beginning. Now, the theatrical premiere was episode 5, correct?
Yes.
Okay, so let's go back to the very beginning.
Oh, wow.
Okay, way back to segment number 1 of Stonington Classic. And I'm looking at you, Nick, because it was you, right? Was this your idea?
It was me and it was Elias.
Yes.
But originally it was an assignment by our media teacher, Mr. Shokas. And basically, the assignment was that we had to make a creative spin on the morning announcements at Stonington High School. And so, first episode of Classic Stonington was, we had a cute little intro. Mr. Lewis appeared in the intro. That was his first appearance.
What did we get for a grade on this, by the way?
We did get an A.
All right.
We got an A. I think we got an A plus, to be honest.
I think so.
It was A plus work, if I do say so myself.
But yeah, so the first episode was just like this cutesy little intro, and we did the morning announcements, and it was really nothing too special, but we thought, hey, wouldn't it be fun to just keep going with these, make a story, see how it progresses over time.
Now, in number 2, there were still announcements and stuff.
Number 2, yes. I think number 2 is funny because it kind of breaks the fourth wall a little bit, because during us giving the announcements to the school, a bear shows up, and there are zombies in the school, and they've taken over. And so we have to get out of there, and we have to deal with the problems that are going on.
Yeah, that was like, the thing about like making all these episodes is that we wanted to do so much.
Oh.
And by like episode 3, we were just like, we thought to ourselves, how are we going to be able to do all of this? And looking at how much we've accomplished with episode 5, looking back at those first 2 episodes and how we were still just making the morning announcements is just so weird.
Yeah.
Well, you had to start somewhere, right?
Yeah.
And so then there was episode number 3.
Episode number 3. We had always wanted to do Lord of the Rings. We kind of hinted at Lord of the Rings a little bit in episode 2 when Carissa, my co-anchor, and I, we ran up to Mr. Lewis outside his classroom. We're like, Mr. Lewis, save us from the bear, and he used his lightning powers, which he wanted his death.
Yeah, it was originally going to be Kung Fu, and then Nick just goes,
hilarious.
Lightning powers.
That would be hilarious. Mr. Lewis, like, surges of lightning from his fingers just at the bear. And so that was kind of hinting at, like, some fantasy, like, mythological kind of thing. But yeah, episode 3, we just love the Lord of the Rings.
Oh, yeah.
Peter Jackson's
huge fans.
And so we thought it would just be great if it was the classic Stonington characters, but in the Lord of the Rings universe.
And by that time, we had, I don't want to say really a reputation, but we were kind of known for making these. And so we got our English teacher, Mr. Cody, to be this kind of Saruman character. And that was funny because didn't we want him for the first episode?
What's funny is that for the role of Mr. Lewis's character in the series, and I don't think you know this, but we first...
There's a lot I don't know about.
We went to 2 people before we
episodes.
Went to you.
Oh, you tell me now.
That's right.
Am I aging aware?
We first went to Mr. Cody, but he had, I think he had AP Lit. That
period. Yeah, he had AP Lit.
And he wasn't able to do it. And so we were like, huh, who else is there?
And that was my planning period.
Yeah, and we went to Miss Divine. And Miss Divine had a study hall, and she just wasn't able to do it. And I was like, oh my God. And then I kind of realized, I was like, every kid has to take health. Who teaches health?
Mr. Lewis.
And I was like, everyone knows him. He's got the star power.
Oh, okay. It's
and the
notoriety anyway.
He's got the personality. So we went to him, and it just went from there. It's perfect.
Yeah.
And it built up. And
built up and built
yeah.
up.
Episode
and these
four.
Episodes, I don't know if your viewers are aware. They probably aren't because, a few of them might be high school students, but they aired during the morning announcements in home base every day. Nick would and others would do the morning announcements, but there would occasionally be time for one of these feature video presentations, and so the students in the building did get to see these.
Yeah,
and they enjoyed them as a home base.
Great feedback.
It was crazy.
Yes, I heard about it too from my granddaughter.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And she was bummed that she couldn't go to the premiere for episode 5 because they were out of town.
It really is a shame. Yeah, we had a couple of our cast members who couldn't come to the premiere either because they were out of town.
Yeah, because it was so much fun, and everybody was laughing. It was just so much fun.
We originally planned for the premiere to be like late June, early July.
Oh yeah,
but,
that wasn't gonna happen.
That was not gonna happen.
First off, because of the editing, we had so much left to do. But also because of the fact that everyone in the beginning of summer is out vacationing, doing stuff, and back towards August, people are starting to come back and get ready for the next year of school or work or whatever they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
So
the editing. With that one was just so unprecedented. We had no idea how long it was going to take. I thought maybe a couple weeks. We didn't expect it to take a month and a half.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
It's people that don't understand that. It takes sometimes longer to edit, twice, sometimes three times as long to edit as it does. For instance, this show is an hour long. Okay, but if we do a remote, we have to piece it together. Oh my goodness. Yes, indeed. It takes hours. And not just hours to have the segues nice and smooth make sure that the audio is balanced because you've got people running around there but talking close by over here. So there's a lot of balancing to worry about. And then there's the music. Now, the music, you add that in last, right?
Yes, the music. Yeah. This is funny. We added the music like 3 days before the movie premiered.
Oh, boy.
And I came over, and he was just like, we got to do this.
Yeah.
Like, we were
really cramming in the end, but that was all the audio stuff. The beginning couple weeks in July, I was starting to wrap up the visual effects, and then we started editing in like the second to last week of July, and then right before the premiere, a few days, we started getting all the audio stuff and compiling it all together, and then we had to export it for one single video to send to the theater for the premiere.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Now, how did you decide? I've always wanted to ask this. Ever since I used to have an ad agency, and one time we did a commercial for Eastman Kodak that was for one of their divisions, and we worked with
it was a long time.
Yeah, it was a long. It was back in the 80s, the early 80s. Stevie Wonder. We worked with Stevie Wonder. We had to meet him in New York City. Now, Stevie Wonder is blind, okay? So daytime, nighttime, same thing to him. So we had to work around his schedule. So it turned out that we started with him at 2 o'clock in the morning.
Wow.
But it was like one take. I mean, the guy's amazing. But it's not always. So it took us a while to determine what music that we wanted to use for the commercial. Now you have a whole film, all these different scenes, and to make the smooth segues and get the right feeling in these scenes, you've got to have the right music.
Yeah.
So everybody kind of pitched in on that one?
I had nothing to do with it.
Except for you and me, right? Okay, these guys.
It was mostly Nick as far as picking out the music because producer.
Myself and Eli, Evan, obviously.
Yeah, I as the producer, I basically just I was chipping in ideas during the early writing stages.
Right.
And as the production went along, I was just basically helping out setting up the premiere and just throwing in as much help as I could, because I felt so powerless towards the editing stages, because I'd come over to Evans and he'd just be sitting there. He's like, yeah, I just got to work. And I'm like, I wish I could help you. I really do. But I just, yeah. I don't know what Nick wants out of this.
Yeah.
The music was, I found it surprisingly easy, and people are going to look at the movie and hear all the music and think, wow, this must have taken so much work. But when we got to those last 3 days finding music, it just baffled me how easy it was to find the right music. Like, I'd just be on YouTube just like looking up Star Wars music, like full soundtracks from all the movies, and I'd find one. I'd be like, hey, Evan, doesn't this sound great? And he'd be like, yeah, that's perfect. And we put it in, and then it was just done like that. And
we were talking earlier off camera, though, but you have a lot of a background, a memory, a log of a
oh,
lot of
yeah,
music
of
that,
course,
that
because, I mean, we've been making
music.
Movies for so long.
Long time.
We have all this music, some of our favorite, like, soundtracks that we got to use in some movies.
Like Schindler's List.
Like, oh, God, no.
Oh, okay, are we going to talk about that? No. Well, obviously, there are some Star Wars effects in the movie, so you pull some of the Star Wars music.
Yes.
Tell us about some of the other music that you, and of course, you're musical anyway.
Yeah, we both are musical.
All of us are, yeah.
So maybe that makes it a little bit easier. But what other music did you pull in to the scenes?
In episode five?
Episode 5 and 4.
Okay. 4 was musicals.
Oh, 4 4 was tons of musicals.
Tons
so it was
yeah.
4 was our musical episode.
Yeah. 4 4 was my baby. I loved that episode.
That was his brainchild.
Yeah. That was everything from Les Misérables to Mulan.
Willy Wonka.
Willy Wonka mm-hmm. was the overarching story, but we also had music from Schindler's List in that for a little bit. Lord of the Rings, Star Wars, Adam's Family. The musical, because
we had just done a production.
Yeah, we had just done a production
Which
of Adam's
great.
Family.
Yeah,
so
you were Gomez. Yes.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah.
Okay. So, not only do you have to get the right music, but you've got to get the right talent from the student body.
Right.
And so, how did you decide who should play whom, and who actually wrote the scripts?
Okay. The first one, we really did not, the first episode, which was just the morning announcements, we really didn't have a script.
Yeah, we didn't
have
one.
Because the front office always prints out the morning announcements. They have a list of all the things that we need to say. So it was easy as that. We just went through episode 2, you wrote.
Yes, I wrote that, and I wrote the bones of the script for 3 and 4. But you helped me out with a lot of it.
Yeah, because when we got to episode 4, and Elias was like, I want to do a musical. And I was like, I don't know. I was not okay about doing musical. I mean, I love musicals. I've done musicals.
Yeah.
But I was just, I didn't know if I was ready for us to go there as far as our series was. But he and I worked a lot on the script and came up with some pretty good ideas of how to link it to the other episodes to make it seem like it was a more smooth transition. But then when we got to episode 5, I figured, because we only had a few more months left of school, that we got to do Star Wars. Like, everything has been building up to Star Wars, and we knew that we always wanted to do a Star Wars episode. So I took, it was my job to write episode 5, and I started writing it in December, and it took me like 3 or 4 months to write episode 5, and then we started shooting in May. Yeah.
But and as far as the selection of students,
teachers.
They were friends of ours from drama.
Yeah, lots of our friends from drama, just good friends of ours, just happily agreed to be in the movie.
Yeah, the very first few episodes, that's how we got Marcus involved with the project. Marcus was in our group. As was Carissa Coher and Garrett Berger and all the other people who appeared in the very first 3 episodes.
They were just in our media class.
Yeah, they were in our media class. And then as we went on, we were like, we have to like find people to play like these rebel characters. and all these other characters in the story. And so we just thought it would be really great if we got actors from drama, because they can sing, and that's what we needed mm-hmm. for episode 4. We needed singers, and we got a lot of our friends from drama and from chorus to do that, and they work very professionally.
Yes, they do. Yeah, I would agree.
And teachers.
Episode 5, I mean...
Episode 5.
Episode 5 was...
teachers cameos.
Lots of teacher cameos.
Our principal was actually... There's a cameo.
Yes.
I don't know if we want to spoil that.
Well, that's, I didn't say what...
No, you're right.
In.
But as far as teachers went, after we got Mr. Lewis on board, and he was willing to keep doing these episodes with us because... we never really told him like when the end was in sight. We were just like, hey, can you do this one? Hey, can you do this one? Do you want to just keep doing it? He was just like, yeah, I guess, whatever.
But well, I hope I was more enthusiastic than that. I really
No.
I enjoyed the whole process.
Yeah, but Mr. Cody was just, he really took us off guard because we wanted him for episode 3, but we loved him because... we thought it was perfect because he's a huge Lord of the Rings fan. And we thought, it'd be great if he was in our Lord of the Rings episode.
Yeah.
And he was just, my God.
Yeah, he just is so incredible.
He stole the scene. Phenomenal. He was I'd never seen him act before. And he was just so wicked and just, yet I couldn't believe it. He was just, he was amazing. And as far as the other teachers go...
Mr. Stanley. He had some convincing in order to get him into the series.
He didn't want to do it. Really? He is an actor, and he is in musicals, and he's our chorus teacher.
Me,
yeah, and he didn't. He was very reluctant about doing it, but he surprised us too. I don't know why he did, but he was also very, very good. I'm just so glad we were so fortunate to have such talent all in one place.
Not only talent, but support.
Exactly.
It seems to me like the whole school was involved in supporting your projects.
Yeah,
we used the principal's office. We used lots of different.
Oh yeah, we used the library.
Parts of the elevator.
The elevator.
We couldn't get access to, you know, had it not been for the administration.
Exactly. Yeah.
Oh yeah, getting the principal in the episode was just so cool because we'd be walking down the halls and people would just be asking about Classic Stonington, and that's when it really hit us that what we were making people actually really cared about. We cared a lot about them, but we didn't know that other people were really watching.
Right, we were just kind of making it because we loved making it. We didn't know anyone else liked it, you know. But, yeah.
So you've got the whole school involved. You've got a huge fan base, family, friends, the other students.
Right.
And you had mentioned something as we were talking before the show about episode 6. Okay, episode 6 is, these young people, we're going to talk about it in the second half, what they're going to be doing with their future and how this affected them and all of that. But what we're talking about are the first 5 episodes. And so you were talking about a possibility of an episode 6.
It started off as a joke.
It did start off as a joke. Way back in December when I was writing episode 5, I realized at a certain point that episode 5 was huge and that it was too big and there was too much that I wanted to say and that we wanted to say collectively as a group to finish up the story. There was just too much that you could do in one episode.
And it is twice the length.
It's 50 minutes, and it's the first episode was 6 minutes. So they just kept growing, but I always thought maybe we could split episode 5 into 2 parts. And I was thinking maybe we could do... There came up the idea of doing a 6th one, but I really didn't think we needed to do a 6th one. It didn't seem that necessary. I was like, I can do it in one episode. We can finish the story in episode 5. It'll probably be really long, but I just thought that delaying it further and worried that we weren't going to finish before school end. I just thought it was a lot better that we did 5 episodes. But I don't know how long after, but we started talking about how fun it would be is if we revisit these characters and these storylines 20 years down the road, where I'm like this old Jedi Master, this bearded Jedi Master who returns to Stonington to find that evil is still there. And it just kind of grew from there. We actually do have several different plot points that we're talking about right now.
Back to the Future is one of them. Right?
Because we want to stick to our whole theme of doing, of each episode being a ripoff of another movie, like, you know. Mm-hmm. And so we might do...
Parodies.
Parody. Just a parody of each episode. So we were thinking maybe episode 6 could be like, have something to do with time travel, or it could be like Back to the Future, like he said. We might mm-hmm. dabble in that. But yeah, episode 6 is a very real thing.
Yeah.
And of course, you all will be famous doing your work.
Hopefully, we'll
be talking more about the second part of the show. Yeah. But I think that's great. I may not. 20 years from now? But I'm sure you're still going to be around,
well,
right?
That's the plan.
we were talking.
Yeah.
Yeah.
By the way, fame. What's fame last? 20 minutes?
Well, they say 15, but sometimes 15 it stretches minutes. To 20. Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. Infamy now. Infamy lasts a bit longer.
That's right. Yeah.
Now, well, let's just talk with you for a few minutes, okay? So they approached you. Have you ever acted?
I was the third choice.
Now that we know this. But still, you were the right choice. That's the key.
You know, I got to be honest. I said earlier that I really, really enjoyed doing this, but if you look, if you view the first couple episodes, I think, a horrible actor at best. Nick was a wonderful coach, and I think... By the fifth episode,
you really improved.
Well, I appreciate that. But he literally would, you know, when it came to filming my scenes, he would read it and speak the way he wanted me to. I'd ask him to, and then I would do my best to mimic Nick, mm-hmm. and it seemed to work pretty well.
Well, he's kind of an experienced actor.
I'd never acted before, and he certainly has.
Yes, he has.
I thought that was the best approach. Yeah.
But you enjoyed it,
oh,
right?
I loved it. Yeah, it was a lot of fun. And I learned a lot. You know, as I said earlier, well, I teach health. I had nothing to do with cinematography or acting or drama. It was a wonderful learning experience for me. They talked earlier about what goes on behind the scenes and the editing and the writing and everything else. And I really had no concept of any of that prior to doing this. So it was a learning experience for sure.
Well, of course, everything we do is a learning experience for us, right?
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure you all have learned a lot. The fact that you want to do another episode in 20 years means that, man, if I had to do it over again, are you kidding? Of course I would do it, right?
Right.
Oh, absolutely. Oh,
yeah. Yeah.
And I don't know if you were going to ask later, but their college plans relate to acting and...
Yeah, we are going to talk about that because that's very important.
Oh,
because the things that you experience in school as you're growing and changing and maturing affect your plans for the future. Sometimes you've got a blank page and you say, I haven't got a clue what I want to do out there, and it's kind of scary, so I'm going to work for a year and figure it out. But these young men, and you will see the talent in just a couple of minutes and later on in the show too, because we're going to be showing Elias's trailer for the fifth episode of Stonington Classic. And actually, I think we might as well, why don't we pull it out now? Okay? So let's take a look at this trailer, and it'll give you an idea about what this fifth episode is all about.
These kids are determined, but they don't have enough in numbers for a full-on assault. They're gonna need all the help they can get.
Nothing will stand in our way. I will finish what you started.
This is our only chance, guys. If we do this, we do this now.
We will crush the rebellion in one swift move.
Jedi. Like my father before me.
Don't you love it? I just love to see the young talent that we've got today. It gives me hope for the future. So what we're going to do is we're going to take a little break, and when we come back we'll talk more about Stonington Classic and we'll talk about their future. So we'll be right back.
You always made sure I brushed my teeth.
You told me that smart was cool.
You always told me to dream big.
To all of those parents who took the time to make raising their children their most important job, we'd like to say,
thank you.
Thank you.
From the bottom of my heart, thanks, Mom and Dad.
This message is brought to you by the U.S. Air Force.
If you keep tanning, indoors or out, the effects of harmful rays will show up on your skin. Wrinkles, age spots, and an increased risk of melanoma. The second most common cancer in women 15 to 29. Stop tanning. Time may not be on your side. Learn how to protect your skin at spotskincancer.org. A message from the American Academy of Dermatology.
You'd do anything to take care of that spot on your lawn. So why not take care of that spot on your skin? If you're a man over 50, you're in the group most likely to develop skin cancer, including melanoma, the cancer that kills one person every hour. Check your skin for suspicious or changing spots. Go to spotskincancer.org to find out what to look for. A message from the American Academy of Dermatology.
Oh, hey, bud. Where are you headed?
I'm just gonna hang out.
With Gary and Todd?
Yeah.
I've been meaning to ask you, is there any drinking going on in this crowd?
No.
If any of your buddies ever pressure you to take a drink, just tell them you promised your dad you wouldn't.
I'd do anything to keep you safe.
Okay, I will.
I hope this is working.
I promise. Love you too, Dad.
They really do hear you. For tips on what to say, visit underagedrinking.samhsa.gov.
And welcome back to From This Corner TV. And we're having some fun here with the students and one of the teachers that were in the Stonington Classic movie series. And let's talk a little bit more. Number one, we want to talk about the fact that you had this amazing premiere. And I think it's a wonderful thing that they let you have this wonderful event at the Mystic Cinema.
Yes. Mystic Luxury Cinema.
Mystic Luxury Cinema.
Elias and I, we both worked at the theater when we were working on this series. So we were in talks about having a showing there, because the owner there is he's a great guy. He's really open to different ideas and showing different things. So when we actually thought that this could happen, like this became a possible option for us to show that at the theater. We got really excited, and it was really great of them to allow us to do that. There was no charge for the showing, too, which was even more incredible. Like, no one was charged to get in. There were a total of 81 people, I believe, at the premiere.
Wow.
Wow, I didn't know that.
it's a pretty good number.
Yeah, the owner, Bill, has been so absolutely supportive of the two of us. He always asked right up to the premiere how it was going, how the editing was going, when we were going to do showings. I'd show him the trailers and everything, and he was just like right down to the red carpet that he supplied to us. He was really, really supportive of us doing that.
Well, we want to give a shout out to Mystic Luxury Cinema. It was just a great thing for them to do for you guys. Let's talk a little bit more, too, about the special effects, because you do have a lot. I mean, we have the power, you know, the forces.
The star power.
You're moving the furniture.
I enjoyed that.
Yes, well, the visual effects, I came in to Stonington High School in January. I was here before in freshman, sophomore year, but I went away, and I came back in January of senior year. And I didn't start helping out until, like, March or April. And these guys were working on their projects for a while. They've been doing this for a while, and I just heard about it. I'm like, hey, what's this? So the first visual effect that I did was the very end of episode 4 when Nick opened his first lightsaber. And they came up to me, and they're like, hey, can you do this lightsaber effect? And I'm like, I'll give it a go. So I tried it, and they seemed to really like it. So I just kept on going from there, and like, you want to do the visual effects for episode 5? And I said, I'll be down for anything. So, that's pretty much how that started out.
And you had no idea what you got yourself into.
Yeah, exactly.
We didn't know either.
I was way over my head, I think. But it turned out really good, I think, because when we started shooting episode 5, Nick was talking to me, and we were discussing what kind of shots we would have. Like, we were talking about holograms and maybe a spaceship, and I was like, that seems a little challenging, but I'll definitely give it a whirl. And actually, as the episode progressed, you can kind of notice, how different the visual effects are, because in the beginning of the episode, there are some lightning effects, and they look more like noodles, and towards the end of effects, they actually look more like lightning. So you can definitely see the progression of the visual effects throughout the film.
Like
itself.
My acting, I think it progressed.
Yeah, exactly. No, exactly.
Yeah, so it was definitely a learning curve, and it was a lot of fun. But it was challenging. It was very, very hard to do. I pulled more than a few all-nighters to get it all done. But it was well worth it.
Well, there were several things in it that were. The ideas came to you from different movies we'd been talking about, like when you open the box and there's a light coming from the box.
Yes, with the hologram. I'd like to say that I owe all the visual effects, or like 90% of the visual effects, to this company called Video Copilot. This guy, Andrew Kramer, he makes these tutorials, sells these products, and it's really incredible the kind of stuff you're able to do with it. And this was actually really recent that he released the products that I was able to use, like the lightsaber that came out in April or May, and the X-Wing, the spaceships. Those came out around that time as well. So if those weren't around, I wouldn't have been able to make those shots.
Yeah,
so
I was wondering how you did those.
It was really fortunate.
Yeah.
Because there's a freaking, there's, I mean, it's amazing.
A spaceship,
A spaceship.
At Stonington High School.
Lands
on the football field.
Exactly, yeah.
It's like, how, we're all sitting there going, oh.
Yeah.
What I think is hilarious about the digital effects is, before we knew that Evan was coming back to Stonington High School, we were already full steam ahead, going to do episode 5. And I had this software on my computer, and it was very rudimentary. It was
frame by frame.
It was like frame by frame, and I could do lightning, and I could do lightsabers, and I think we might still have that ending shot from episode 4 with the first lightsaber that I had tried to do with my software. And at the time, I thought it looked awesome. And then Evan showed up, and he was like, "Oh yeah, I could do that better." And I was like, okay. And he did, and I was like, well, that was a lot better.
You know, what a great reference. I don't know if you've seen that short video I have from maybe 12 or 14 years ago called Spacemen from Outer Space.
Oh, I've never seen that.
I've shown it a couple times in classes near the end of the semester. But the spaceship in that, again, this is 12 or 14 years ago, was two styrofoam picnic plates taped together and suspended against a green screen, I imagine.
Yeah.
And so I think our special effects in Episode 5 especially,
a little bit more
advanced.
I think we're above styrofoam at this point.
Yes, a little bit. And actually, in the two main battle scenes, the first one with the lightsabers and then the other one with the blaster scene, so those two scenes took the most amount of time. It was an incredible amount of work going every shot by shot, getting all of those blasters and lightsabers frame by frame, pulling them through and trying to make it look as real as possible. And it was very, very hard, but I'm extremely pleased with the final result that we got.
Oh, the minigun shot?
Oh, yes. That was especially fun.
Well, I do have to say, you know, you really pulled it out, and it's very, very professional. And we're sitting there in a movie theater watching this movie that was written, produced, acted in by these young people and teachers, and it's just amazing, especially, you know, the effects. I mean, the special effects, you know, you're moving furniture and you're zapping people. And then that ship towards the end, it's like we're all sitting there. We've been laughing through the whole thing. And we're just sitting there awed by what you young people have done. And those mini commercial things that you did too.
The trailers before the show.
Coming attractions.
That was an idea that that I picked up from the movie Tropic Thunder with Robert Downey Jr. and Jack
Ben
Black,
Stiller.
Ben Stiller,
huge cast.
Right, but before that movie, they made their own fake trailers to go before, like these really goofy kind of things, over the top, just hilarious. And so Elias and I thought it would be hilarious if we made our own fake trailers to go before the movie. And so we had a few, but they were a lot of fun.
They were. Oh yeah.
They were. We all enjoyed them.
Yeah.
We really did. Now, you two, I've seen the spy thing when you're chasing you, and his brother are chasing him.
Oh, Terminal Impact.
That was a fun video
at your
we
house,
made.
Yes. Right?
Yeah, was just we just wanted to make like an action shoot 'em up movie.
Yeah, we wanted to just
this was sophomore year fun. And I don't think you've seen this.
I haven't.
No, this it's hilarious. It's
I'd like
it's pretty
a copy.
Great.
It's
yeah, actually possible. You know you can find it on YouTube.
In the past few months we've been talking about making a sequel or a prequel or some other rendition.
We don't know. Just something.
It would be so much fun.
It was really good.
Yeah, well,
it was fun to watch. I enjoyed it.
It was good for sophomore year. It was good for a couple of young high school
sophomore
students.
Year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I wasn't in the...
You weren't.
Yeah.
Sorry. And you weren't either. Sorry about that.
Yeah. No miss to lose.
I guess fortunate just to have been in these.
Yeah.
Well, now, doing all of this, learning what you've learned in high school, being in plays and making your own movies, how has that changed your plans for the future?
Not at all.
You always knew what you were going to do?
I've always known what I wanted to do since I was, 4 or 5, and I was in my first play, and I played the Scarecrow in The Wizard of Oz, and I knew. I was just like, this is what I'm going to do for the rest of my life. And, but this has just solidified my love for making movies. This was just, like, working on this, I was like, wow, that was really hard, but I also loved it. Like, that was so much fun, and I don't know about you.
Well, fun fact, Nick and I have so many similarities, it's kind of scary.
Oh, yeah.
We share the same birthday and the same middle name, but most importantly, we both are huge fans of making movies, and, well, also playing the piano, but yes, we both have a really big passion for making movies, and it's crazy because when I first came to Stonington, we went to different middle schools, but when we first met each other, it was really weird because we met and we're like, hey, you like movies? Yeah, I like movies. And
when's your birthday?
And it just, yeah, pretty much.
What's your middle name?
Is it David?
It grew from there. It just grew up from there, and yeah. we both started making movies together, and we realized that, yeah, this is really, really fun. And we're also going to be going to the same college together, Champlain College in Vermont. And we're both going to be getting a degree in filmmaking.
Yeah, so, yeah. Just so episode six is really going to happen.
Oh, of course it is.
Oh, yes. No. Yes. It's a very, very real thing. Definitely.
Totally.
Yeah, that's interesting, isn't it? Now, Elias.
Yes.
What about you?
I've spent this past year finally realizing that I really love acting, and I have to thank the two of them, Nick especially, for helping me to acclimate. Oh, thanks, buddy. Because I used to look up to Nick as like a hero, because I always looked at the drama productions and stuff like that, and I was like, I'm never gonna do that. And then I did it, and like Nick and I just became really great friends, and through this entire project I've really like worked as a film actor as opposed to doing what I used to do before, which was theater for about like a year and a half before we even started doing this.
Yeah.
And I've really just like realized how much different and how much similar it is. It really is like I learn more and more every single day when it comes to acting, and this project really helped me realize this is what I love doing. And I'm going to be going to University of Connecticut for acting in the fall, and hopefully I'll be doing this for rest of my life, and hopefully I'll be in episode six.
Oh, I'm sure we'll work you in somehow.
Yeah, because people don't seem to think that I'm dead, even though you tried to make
spoilers.
It...
Spoilers!
Oh, we can't go there.
It's not really spoilers.
Yeah,
the
people don't know that.
Well, you know,
like,
that.
It's in the very beginning of the episode, dude. Stuart Stonington dies.
Oh, that's true, man. It's going to be very, these people are going to be very disappointed.
Don't comment.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like, what? In 20 years, we'll have to remind them.
Yeah.
We'll have to remind
will
them.
Will people even know what this is in 20 years?
No one will know what this is.
We'll have to release it in like major theaters, too. Like,
that's true.
Yes. Regal Stonington will have Classic Stonington Episode 6.
If you think about it.
And everyone will be like, where are the other five episodes?
Really, like, in 20 years, after we're going through film school and he's going through acting school, the amount of, like, accomplishments we're going to
talent.
Make in the next 20 years, and the amount of talent that we're going to get from those experiences is incredible. I am super excited for like what the outcome is going to be for the episode six.
It'll be a feature length film. Yeah. It could be 2.5 hours, 3 maybe. It could be an epic.
No, we'll make 3 movies.
We
Peter Jackson
royalties.
Can do it.
Maybe.
We'll milk 3 straight full length movies out of it.
Yeah. Well, now, Nick, you've got to make sure that you're also in front of the camera, okay? Not
yes.
just behind the camera.
Yes, no, definitely.
Because you're a very talented guy.
My character will return, I assure
okay.
you.
Okay, but I mean in your future.
Oh, yes, yeah.
Yeah, you must.
Right, I don't see myself as first and foremost an actor. I'm very, very
more... Tarantino gets a spot in his movie.
Yeah,
movies.
No, exactly.
Yeah.
That's what
yeah,
I hope to... I
exactly.
hope to have just, like, bit parts in my own movies. That's what I hope to do.
I mean, even Alfred Hitchcock was, you know...
Exactly.
I mean, he
right.
made
yeah.
sure
well,
of making it...
Example.
Woody Allen, yeah.
And
yeah.
he didn't know how to act, you know? I mean, geez, here's all this talent here. And actually, I think what I'd like to do right now is pull away from our conversation and show some more of the talent that is in this room. Because Evan made this short movie. Tell us what happened.
Okay, so it was a year and a half ago. I was homeschooled in Oregon. And there was this program at the homeschool I attended, and it allowed you to get high school and college credits, and you would attend the community college. So I went there, I took actual film classes at an actual community college with actual college students, which was very exciting within itself. But there was a project that we were assigned, we were all given the same script, and we were all assigned to reinvent the story and make it our own, and put our own techniques into it. So when I made my film, it's called A Piece of Apple Pie. I decided I'd try and take a more serious route with it. Everyone in the class, most of the people at least, did comedies or something interesting like that. But I decided I want to try and challenge myself, so I decided to do a serious tone to it, and I think the outcome was pretty nice for a junior in high school.
You think pretty nice. You blew me away with it, young man.
Thank you.
You absolutely did, and it's going to blow you away, and just remember, these are young people here.
All of us are young people.
Yes, I'm the youngest of all.
Mr. Lewis might actually be
right.
So we're going to show that piece of apple pie right now. So pay attention, and then we'll be right back.
Need a menu? No. I want a piece of apple pie.
I'm sorry, I'm all out of apple pie.
What's that?
I'm saving that piece. I'm sorry.
You're saving it?
Yeah. I got a regular that comes here this time every night for apple pie. But I have other pies. I have cherry, I have blueberry, lemon meringue.
I want a piece of apple pie.
I'm sorry. The customer would be very disappointed.
But it's okay to disappoint me?
Look, I'll give you any other piece of pie on the house.
No! Listen, if you don't give me that piece of apple pie right now, I'm going to call the police.
The customer is a cop.
I don't care! I want that pie!
I can't.
Don't make me shoot you!
For a piece of pie?
I'm gonna count to five! One! Two!
Stupid!
Getting shot when you don't have to is stupid! Three!
You're being insane!
Oh, really? What's crazier? Killing for a piece of pie or dying for it? Four! Five!
Okay, it's yours.
Could I have another fork and a fresh napkin, please?
Need something to drink?
I'm fine. Thank you.
I never eat apple pie myself.
Why not?
Because of the stuff they spray on them.
What stuff?
I'm not sure. Some sort of spray that causes cancer.
I know what you're trying to do. It's not going to work.
Maybe I'm being too cautious. I mean, no one's getting out of this world alive anyway. Apple pies is a good way to go as any. Better than most.
Shut up! Doesn't make any sense. So, you get this cop coming in here eating apple pie, what, 2-3 times a week?
Sometimes more.
So why didn't you tell this cop about that spray?
Oh, I did, but why would a cop care? Don't you want some coffee to wash that down?
I don't drink coffee.
Why not?
I heard it's not good for you.
Look, this place would empty out real quick if I stopped serving everything that wasn't good for you.
You have a responsibility to your customers.
I'm not twisting anybody's arm.
What do I owe you?
Forget it. It's on me.
Sorry about the gun.
Maybe you should get rid of it.
I just bought it today. It's not even loaded. I'm just tired of being pushed around.
I understand.
Give it to the cop.
Welcome back. What do you think? Pretty darn professional. And I'll tell you something. These young people, all of us.
All of us.
All of us here today.
You and I especially.
There's a lot of talent sitting here at this table. And I'm very excited to see where your future is going to take you. I really, really am. Congratulations on everything that you have done.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.
I'm just so grateful that you were on our show today, and thank you.
Oh, my pleasure.
Mr. Lewis, for joining us too. I always finish with a quote, and the reason I do that is just to kind of summarize kind of the feeling that we've been sharing with you in our show. And so this one, actually, I got from Steve Jobs. Now, of course, he was not in filmmaking or anything, but he was in pretty good business. But it was about the way you feel about work. So Steve Jobs said, your work is going to fill a large part of your life. And the only way to be truly satisfied is to do what you believe is great work. And you guys have done some great work. And the only way to do great work is to love what you do. If you haven't found it yet, but you guys have found it, you're very lucky. Keep looking and don't settle. As with all matters of the heart, you know when you find it. Now you guys have known, you know when you found it, right? Mm.
Yes.
From
yes.
when you were four, whenever you felt that this is it, this is what I'm going to do.
Did you know that early?
A year and a half.
Well, we don't all, but no, I just fell into things. I started on radio when I was 12.
Wow.
And I've just been doing all this kind of stuff ever since. And I've had a lot of fun and done some pretty good stuff. And I'll tell you something, when you get to be my age, you're going to look back on this and say, look where I started. And look what I did. It was pretty damn good, okay? And I kept getting better and better. But back then, I did great work. So you should be very, very proud. And I'm very excited. I'm going to keep track of you guys, okay? I'm going to watch you and hear all about you. And you'll keep me up on everything, right?
Absolutely.
Yes, you will. Well, I'd like to thank you very much for joining us today. It's been a very special show. Close to my heart, because I've seen the plays at Stonington High School. I know Evan and his family, and it's just, I'm blown away by these young people. And I know you are too. And we'll be back again with another great show. And we'll see you then.